Be on guard before him and obey his voice. Do not provoke him, for he will not pardon your transgressions. He won't put up with it. For my name is in him. So, wow, what an interesting scripture. The word angel comes from the Hebrew word malach, and it can mean messenger or ambassador. And moving along here in Exodus 23:22, but if you shall indeed obey his voice, this messenger, and do all that I speak, then I will be an enemy to your enemies and a foe to your foes. For my angel, my messenger, shall go before you and bring you to the Amorites and the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Jebusites, and I will cut them off. And he goes on and continues there and says, you shall not bow down to their gods, nor serve them. And you shall not do according to their works, but you shall surely pull them down, and surely you shall smash their images. I love it when God instructs us to smash things. Later today, we'll all walk into a Chinese restaurant and smash the Buddha idol as we see it. Some say that it was possibly Joshua, that it wasn't an angel, but it might have been referring to Joshua that I've read in different places. Some say it was one of the angels that's mentioned by name, whether it be Gabriel or Michael, some of the angels that are mentioned by name. Some believe that maybe it was, as it's mentioned many times, the angel of the Lord, and so that Messiah was there with them. And even, of course, we know he already existed. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. We know what the Scriptures say, without him was not anything made that was made. So, and he was there, he's there with them. So it's possible that we can look at it thinking that was that Messiah with them. And so these are all ideas. And so today I'm going to throw out an idea too. And that's all it is, it's just an idea. And I'll kind of give you an idea of why I have this idea. If I have a question, and I'm going to call somebody and ask them that question. In other words, they're the recipient of the question, I'm the sender of the question, and this is kind of like the messenger. This is kind of how the message gets sent through this. And so, I'm going to throw out the idea today because it goes along with what I'm talking about. Primarily is what I'm throwing out this crazy idea. What if the messenger is not a person? It's a man. What if the messenger is prayer? Just a crazy thought, And again, I'm kind of crazy, so hey, look, it fits well. And let's look at this. The same scripture, behold, I send prayer before you, to keep you in the way and to bring you to the place which I have prepared. Be on guard before him and obey his voice, and do not provoke him, for he will not pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him. There's just something about prayer there that connects us with God and helps us to hear from God. And so prayer is a type of messenger, we could say. I love the scripture here within the Torah portion. And it says, you shall serve, and the word serve there can also mean labor, work, or worship. You shall serve and we don't see that in our English translations, but it's that Hebrew word, aleph mam, is in there. A good hay off the head of the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your water, and I will take sickness away from the midst of you. I've got some bread at home. I've got some water. I've got some water at home on my island in the kitchen. It's called crazy water. It's supposed to have a lot of minerals and stuff in it. That's actually what it's called on the name of the bottle. So, you know, here it says, and you know, their diet wasn't like a big variety. And we talked a little bit about this last week. I think it was last week. Don't put your faith in the label of your foods. Put your faith in the Father. Put your faith in God. Yes, He can help you if you can, but don't put your faith there. Don't put your trust in what you're eating or what you're buying. Put your faith in God. I believe their diet was limited. I mean, they ate manna, they ate quail. It doesn't really say a whole lot of health, but they drank water. I mean, it sustained them. But it wasn't. I mean, where were the fruit and vegetables? Where was the barley? You know, where was all the part of their barley? Where were some of the other things? And they actually, at many times, complained about, we missed the onions, we missed some of this stuff we ate back in Egypt. And they would complain about their food sometimes. I don't know if you ever complain about your food. Some people are just that way. Some people never out of grow up. Sometimes as kids, they complain a lot. I don't like that. That looks yucky. That, you know, even if they never tasted it. Sometimes adults, they never change, and they're still like that. I'm just the opposite. I'll pretty much eat anything. I don't care what it tastes like. You know, I'm like, I don't care. You know what food tastes like for the most part. Occasionally, my father-in-law gave us a truck. It was an old truck that he didn't want anymore, and he had some crackers in there. And so I guess he said, every once in a while, he'd get heartburn, and he would help him. He'd drive in, he'd one of those crackers, little saltine crackers and some packages. So I guess this last week I was driving, you know, and I'm just getting a little hungry, and I saw the crackers there, and I'm like, I'm going to take a bite of that cracker. And so as I'm driving, I put the cracker in my mouth, and I tell you what, it was the worst tasting cracker I think I've ever had. I started spitting it out, and I kind of made a mess in the truck, and then I think it was like, gosh, almost 10 years old or something. And I was like, oh, I kind of hope I don't get sick. I mean, you know, occasionally we think I may get something. Anyway, back on track here, I want you to think about this. When we serve God, He's going to bless our bread and our water. He'll put the nutrition into it. I will take sickness away from the midst. He will do it. Lean on by that. If they've got vitamin C and A and B6 X, Y, Z, and magnesium, you know, then I won't be sick. You know, you hear things. Oh, you're feeling bad, better take some vitamin C. And, I mean, we try to help each other. There's nothing wrong with that. But think about what God's saying. I will take sickness away from the midst of you. I will do it. Your bread's not going to do it. Your water's not going to do it. I'm going to do it. And somehow I think it's connected with us serving Him. And so there's a lot of different ways that we can serve Him. And I'm specifically going to talk about one way this morning. And we can serve God through prayer and supplication. I have had friends that were missionaries, friends that were pastors, friends that were worship leaders, friends that were evangelists. I've got all kind of those also in my family. And there's been a many a times I've had to ask myself, because you know, sometimes you grow up watching things and being in ministry, and you see ministers on TV always begging for money. That used to be the case in the day. I remember some of my relatives saying, I love the preaching, but I hate when they start begging for money. And I've been in churches like that where they give the big pool for money, and sometimes ministries do. I'll tell you what, if you send me $10, I'll give you a buck that I anointed with oil or something. You know, I'm going to send you some holy water. Now, I'm not saying that's all bad, but sometimes when the focus is just all about, you know, give us your money, and you know, we get off track there. And I've seen some ministries where it seems like they feel like they can't do anything without a whole bunch of money. One of the things about this is, I tell you what, I don't know about you. It doesn't cost me any money to pray. Yeah. That's one of the maybe more humble ministries, but it's one of the most important ministries. Not up here speaking, not maybe playing a guitar, but a prayer, an intercession, and supplication. And it don't cost any money to really do that. As far as I know, I don't think so. You know, oh my gosh, we're missionaries. We need hundreds of millions and thousands of dollars, you know, so we can preach the gospel. Like you do. I mean, yes, you need some money, but give me a break, you know. But there's going to be a balance there. We can serve God through prayer and supplication. Anyone can. Anyone can. And we all should think about it. And God's wanting you to think about it today. In Luke 2:13, 2:37, and she is talking about the prophetess Anna. When they brought Messiah in the eighth day, and as they named him Yeshua, as the angels told them, and he got circumcised. There was two different people there that acknowledged who he was and this God showed them. And this is the second one. The prophetess Anna was a widow for 84 years. That was after her husband died. And I think it says in the previous scripture she was married about 7 years. That puts her in her 90s. Who did not depart from the temple, serving God with prayers, fastings and prayers, night and day. You know, some people might not look at her as being too significant, a 90-year-old woman, but I tell you what, she probably had a profound impact. They're serving God with fastings and prayers. What a great way to serve God through prayer. I had looked up some folks this morning. I was just curious what all good folks around here about prayer. And I think I posted it on my Facebook page. It was a quote by Corey Ten Boom, and I thought that's a pretty good quote. And I remember writing something like, it has to do with prayer making you think. Is prayer to you like, is it like the steering wheel, or is it like the spare tire? You know, is prayer to you like the steering wheel, or is it like the spare tire? You only have it there in case you really need it. Otherwise, you know, you don't touch it. Or is it really steering things to come to you? Well, I've made up some of my own phrases over the years about prayer, and I just wanted to share them with you this morning. And I guess you could call it my prayer point. Prayer is a mighty weapon. Prayer is a mighty tool. Prayer makes things happen. To not do it, I'd be a fool. You'll pray if you care. You'll pray if you dare. Your problems to share, your burdens to bear. God is listening for you. Are you talking to Him? He delights to help you. Are you trusting in Him? You have not because you ask not. So ask and believe. Believe and receive. Be patient and wait. Don't give up in haste. God is very great. He is never late. Amen. And prayer makes hell away. I should have had a space there. Prayer makes Satan shake. Prayer makes bondage break. Prayer makes demons name. Go ahead and do not delay. Go ahead and make God's day. Go ahead and begin to pray. Pray, believe, and receive today. Amen. The Bible says in Proverbs 15 that the prayer of the upright is God's delight. He delights to hear from us. He doesn't want us to walk around being religious. He wants a relationship with us. Tell you what, somebody that had a relationship with God, that had connection with God, was Moses. In Exodus 24, Moses alone shall come near the Lord, but they shall not come nigh. Neither shall the people go up with him. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord, and rose up early in the morning, and built an altar under the heel with 12 pillars, according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount, and the glory of the Lord abode upon the mount of Sinai, and the cloud covered it. 6 days, and the seventh day, he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And the sight of the glory of the Lord was like devouring fire on top of the mount to the eyes of the children of Israel. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and got himself up to the mount. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. That's a long time. As Moses was there, he wasn't playing video games. As Moses was there, he wasn't playing checkers with God. He wasn't there watching TV. He wasn't there reading a collection of books. I believe he was there connecting with God, communing with God, talking with God, and listening to God. Moses was a man of prayer. Moses was a mediator between God and Israel. More than anything else, Moses connected with God, and he spoke to God over and over and over again. So should we. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. And it means what he says. I don't know who Mr. Thessalonians is, but I think he meant what he said. Anyway. And Moses besought the Lord in Exodus 32:11. And Moses besought the Lord, his God, and said, Lord, why are you angry? Your wrath is waxed hot against your people, which thou hast brought forth out of the hand of Egypt with great power with a mighty hand. He's talking to God. Thank you, brother. There it is. I'll read it again. And Moses besought the Lord his God. He said, Lord, why does thy wrath wax hot against thy people, which thou hast brought forth out of the land of Egypt? I want to remind you with a great power with a mighty hand. expressing his discontentment, his anger at Israel. He wants to punish them. He wants to give them a kick. He's done with them. And Moses begins to intercede. Moses begins to be the mediator. Moses prays. What do you think about this? God has said something. And God can say something to us. And what do? Do we talk back to God? Do we talk to Him about it? There's an amazing thing called communication. And it's an art that's been lost by some. It's believed because of technology that we have, whatever it be, our tablets, our phones, or whatever. Many people prefer to text rather than talk face to face. And especially young people, they're more into that type of communication. A lot of them have a hard time communicating face to face. That a lot of them don't really even know how to relate to each other like in the old days. Can you imagine even how it affects our relationship with God? God doesn't have a cell phone up in heaven. Oh, God, if I could just text you, it'd make life a lot easier. God doesn't work that way. After Moses had prayed and interceded, and the Lord repented of the evil which he thought to do unto his people. Moses praying to God, turned to God's heart, is almost how it seems to be. You might be amazing at what prayer can do in your life. We may think, well, that's just the way it is. I just have to deal with what comes to me. I've got no choice. I'm just a pathetic person. I've got a pathetic wife, a pathetic relative. It's just the way God has dealt it to me. I want you to know that prayer can change things. Man, I'm just messed up. That's just the way it is. I think sometimes I used to know people in a particular church. I met my wife in a charismatic church I used to go to years ago. And it's a great place to meet a wife. It's a good church. We met there at this church, and at different times they'd have people come in. And again, it's a spirit-filled, charismatic church. And at times they'd have people be brought in, prophets or whoever, that would prophesy. And we can remember certain people that would really have a gift of prophecy strong. And nothing wrong with that. I believe in prophecy. I believe in all the gifts of the Spirit. But there's some people that kind of just, they feel like, and I encourage you to be careful about this, I've met other people similar to this. They don't really have a relationship with God like they should. They don't really know the Scriptures like they should, for whatever reason, I'm not to judge them. But they'll hear a prophecy and they run with it. And so whether it be good or bad, and they feel like their whole life is angry about this word of prophecy that was given. We've had different times prophets come here before. And I can't remember what the one guy's name, or he flows in prophetic ministry. The one guy from Iran. What was his name? Manuel. And as he came, and he's been here a couple of times. It's been a while since he's been here. I mean, at the end of the service, he's prophesying over people, giving them words, and people are falling out of the power of the Spirit of God. He had a messianic congregation. Yeah, it's happened here. I mean, that happens all the time. That's not what we live for. I mean, that's not like, oh, I have to have that happen, or I can't go on with God. You know, sometimes people get in that place where they feel like that's what it's all about. If I don't fall down, I haven't really connected with God. I mean, I don't care if you fall or not. I mean, it's great if you truly fall and you felt God's power. But anyway, as this guy was speaking God's heart to people, and I was there helping to catch it. I know other people might have been in here. I know Jim was probably there helping at different times to catch people if they were going to fall. And I'm there listening to all the prophecies, and I know some of them I thought, you know, that's right on, that's right on, yeah, I know that's right. And other times I'm thinking, you know, I'm not sure. And it could be, but I'm not sure. And I know that means he's a bad guy, if anybody can miss it. You know, and then years later, as I think about things that were spoken over me, maybe my children or whatever, I think, well, God, I just don't know. I never saw that come to pass, and I'm definitely not sure about what he said there. And other things, I'm like, I know that was right, that was dead on. So what I'm saying is that our lives shouldn't be based upon some preacher on TV, you know, breathing, spitting, and sweating, and all that. Not some preacher in your local area. Not on some web blog or some web ministry. Is your life with God shouldn't be based on some one prophecy that someone gave you. Yes. I mean, God spoke something, and then Moses prayed, and things changed. I want you to know that, prayer can change your life, your family. Prayer can change a nation. And so our relationship with God should be primarily about our communication with Him, our prayer with Him, our listening to Him, and talking with Him. I mentioned last night, I'm kind of 57. I've got all kind of different backgrounds in my life, including Irish. I know my wife's got Jewish and Irish, and sometimes we think about Patrick's and Patrick's Day coming up. I don't necessarily call people saints, and of course he wasn't Irish himself, but he became a missionary to the Irish people, and if you study his life in the younger days, he was a man of prayer. He offered up to God hundreds and hundreds of prayers a day, hundreds and hundreds of prayer a day. Prayer is communicating and conversing with the absolute all-powerful, almighty creator of the galaxies. We should not neglect that. Prayer is faith and trust demonstrating itself in the highest power that exists. It's something powerful. Prayer is fellowship and relationship with your Heavenly Father. We need it. It's life. Prayer is a means of interacting with the invisible, invisible, incredible, omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient, master, and maker of all creation. And I'll say that 10 times as fast as you can. You ever get that stuff? Okay, if you send this to somebody, then you'll be blessed. You know, if you send this to 10 people, see what happens. Hey, well, be careful with that kind of garbage. Yeah. You know, you pray Hail Mary 12 times, and then God will finally hear you. In the way that we do things. I love learning Philippians chapter 4. In Philippians chapter 4, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything. By prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Messiah Yeshua. James says some things about prayer. I bet James, who was a half-brother of Yeshua, it says that they call him old camel knees because when he prayed, he liked to get out on his knees. And because he prayed so much, it made his old knees kind of tough and rough. And he had the nickname of, I don't know if he wore short enough clothing you could see his knees. I don't know how, you know, hardly you don't ever see my knees. They're not really that great looking. That's why I keep them covered. But you know, that might doesn't sound good, maybe old camel knees. But when you think about why he was called that, it was an honor. And he says some of these things as he was inspired, as he wrote, but if any of you lacks wisdom, that's pretty much all of us, we have to admit, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and with no reproach, and it shall be given to him. But let him ask in faith, nothing doubt, nothing. Down is like a wave of the sea driven by the wind and tossed. For do not let that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. If we're asking and we're not believing, we're not trusting, then we just really shouldn't be asking. It's not going to do us any good, is what James is telling us there. And then later here in chapter 5, is any among you afflicted? Well, then start complaining about it. No, let him pray. Is any cheerful? Well, let him sing songs, praises to God. Is any sick among you? Then go to the doctor, well, if you have to. But he says, let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. That's it, just so we can look religious. No, that's not it. And the prayer of faith will cure, will make well the sick, and the Lord will raise them up. And not only that, you get 2 for 1, and if he's committed any sins, they'll be forgiven him. So not only are you getting healed as they come, if there was any sins, they're going to be taken care of. Confess your faults one to another. Don't leave it there. Run to gossip. Pray for one another that you may be healed. That the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous person avails much. Sometimes we confess our faults to one another, and it just seems like they spread and other people talk about them. He doesn't say confess your problems, your faults, maybe your sins to one another to see who's got the worst problems. Sometimes people do that. Oh, you think you're bad? Listen to what I've gone through. Some people do that. Oh, yeah, well, I can top that. And I'll tell you what happened to me this week. Oh, yeah, well, you know, sometimes that's the idea. But it says we're to confess, to bond with each other, to pray for one another, and not just so we look at religious. Oh, yeah, we pray. Okay, then we'll do it, you know. But we pray for one another that we may be healed, because there's healing that comes as we connect and we pray and we trust. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous person makes tremendous power available, I think it says there in the Amplified. Elijah, he was not a superhero. He was a man of like passions as we are. And he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it did not rain on the earth for the time of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, the heaven gave rain, and the earth caused its fruit to sprout. I mean, that's just an example. We know he was a prophet, but at the same time, he was just a human. He was just a man. And he prayed, and he trusted, and he prayed earnestly. I mean, that was some powerful praying. God wants some people today that know how to pray, that can offer up some powerful prayers, that can connect heaven to earth. Prayer precedes paramount, prestigious, powerful products. And we hear all kinds of things. In Mark chapter 1, verse 35, rising very early in the morning, as he set his alarm clock, as he didn't have an alarm clock back then, so I don't know how he did this, the Spirit of God moved him. Rising early in the morning while it was still dark, he, Yeshua, departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. Messiah was a man of prayer. An old pastor friend of mine who's gone on to be with the Lord, he used to be in a prayer ministry at, I don't remember what the guy's name was, some well-known minister. He said he was in their prayer ministry, and he would answer phones and pray for people, and he did that for a season, and they had a huge prayer room. And he said in the prayer room, it was very nice, very plush, you know, couches and different things. And he said, unfortunately, a large percentage of the time you go in there and you find people sleeping. I guess they made it a little too cushy. You know, Messiah, he went out to a desolate place. You know, maybe sometimes we make things too cushy. You know, and we can't. I know the one brother last week, and I appreciate you doing that. He had to stand up because his flesh was getting weary. And so he had to stand up. And, you know, we had a guy last night and fell asleep over here and started snoring pretty loud. So we had to wake him up. He was tired. You know, flesh gets weary. And so sometimes we have to keep our flesh in check. You know, if I sit on this couch and I'm going to make myself comfortable and pray. You know, years younger, I would try to make a habit of staying up all night in prayer occasionally. And sometimes I do it at the synagogue. And I wasn't careful, but the old flesh would sure want to sleep. You know, and especially if I'm like, I think I'm just going to lay down and pray. You know, it had a bad decision. So sometimes we have to keep ourselves in check. Messiah was the Savior. Messiah was the Son of God. But yet he prayed. He spent time in prayer. In Luke 6, verse number 12, in these days he, Messiah, went out to the mountain to pray, and all night he continued in prayer to God. All night long. And of course, out on the mountain, he didn't have a no place to really lay down and comfortable. And sometimes we have to do that. We have to say, you know what, I feel like I really need to pray. I've got a word to pray. And so in order to do that, I've got to do what I need to do. You know, and God will give you the strength if it's truly the Lord. In Luke 11, verse 12, now Yeshua, Jesus was praying in a certain place. And when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray. And John called his disciples, and he said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation. And then he goes on, and he continues to teach them about prayer. He said to them, which of you who has a friend to go to him at midnight, and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine has arrived on a journey, and I have nothing to send before him. And he will answer from within, do not bother me. The door is now shut, Judas, he will rise and give him whatever he needs. And so he goes on and he's telling them, so I tell you, ask and it will be given you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks it will be opened. And then he goes on and says, what father among you, his son asks for a fish, will he instead of the fish give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, will he give him a scorpion? I hope not. If you then were evil, natural humans, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? There's just something about asking and asking. The person that came at midnight, the other person said, oh my gosh, I'm in bed. You know, I mean, the door's closed. I mean, back then it was a little different too. They didn't have electricity. I mean, it was probably a little harder to do things. So it was going to take some time, some work to get out of bed, get a light on. And so he says there, he didn't do it because he was his friend. He did it because they were just so damn good persistent. And they seemed like they're just. If I went over to my house and somebody knocks, we've got about four dogs, and then they start barking, and we're just like, oh my gosh. And so sometimes we've got cats too, and sometimes in the middle of the night they decide to bite each other. And so a couple of nights ago, 1 o'clock in the morning, I'm hearing, so I have to get up and break up the cat fight. And so, and I didn't get anything out of it. I didn't get any bread. I didn't have to get any bread. I just kind of kicked the cat and went back to bed. That they should always pray and not lose heart. He said in a certain city there was a judge, a bad judge. He didn't fear God nor respected man. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, give me justice against my adversaries. And she kept saying, she kept on. Now for a while he refused, but afterward he said to himself, though I fear not God, I don't respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice, so that she will not beat me down with her continual coming. And the Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge says, and will not God give justice to his elect, and quieting them day and night? Will he delay along over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Wow, what a powerful question. We know that the Son of Man is going to be coming. We know that Messiah is coming soon. When he comes, will he find faith? And what does that faith look like? What does that faith really express itself like? True faith. I'm not talking about religion. I'm not talking about people trying to be good. What is true faith? Express itself like when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith? One of the things that Messiah rebuked his disciples, his Talmudim, over many times was their lack of faith. I'm amazed at some of the powerful scriptures, and we're just looking at a few of them today, as Messiah had declared to us from John 14, truly, truly I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. And greater works than these will he do, because I'm going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. What a powerful promise that he's given to us there of asking the Father in Messiah's name. And a few weeks back, we talked a little bit about names, Shemot, and we talked a little bit about that name, the Yeshua. And there's just something about when we pray, you know, we've got no access to God as a human. All of our deeds are like a filthy rag. There is none righteous, it says in Romans. No, not one. Jew or Gentile, we're all guilty. We're all so from that aspect, we have no merits on our own to be able to come to God and say, God, help me. God, can you heal me? Can you heal my relative? Can you help me over here? But when we say, Bashem Yeshua, when we say in the name of Yeshua, it's as though as if Yeshua comes into the picture and everything changes. You know, if I come to someone and I just say, hey, can you help me? Well, who are you? You know, we don't do well. I'm here on behalf of so-and-so. Oh, absolutely. Come right in. Let me help you. That's kind of like the way it is when we come before the Almighty. This and that, you know, in the name of Yeshua, in the name of Messiah. Oh, well, okay then. It's as though as if Messiah is there asking. When we ask in His name, powerful things can happen. We're praying His authority. I'm reminded years ago, so exciting getting my driver's license as a teenager. And we lived in a little town called Ranger, population about 1,000. And they didn't really have much there. Not much at all. That's why we actually moved there, because my mom thought it would be safer for teenagers to live there. But in all reality, there's evil everywhere. And so she thought, oh, I don't want to live in a big city. It's probably got drugs and hoodlums and all kinds of things. And so, you got to trust God. You know, I've been living here in San Antonio for whatever it is, 11 years. I've got 4 kids. You know, we didn't live that way. Oh my gosh, we can't move to the city. Bad things. I mean, we just trust God wherever you're at. You know, I remember there was a movie, and if anybody remember the guy Carmen, the singer who still sings, he had put a movie out many years ago, and I can't remember what it was, and it talked a little bit about that. In the movie, he had a son. His son was being bullied or something, and so he did some research. I don't remember the name of the movie. I hope I'm not butchering it. But anyway, in the movie, he moved to, I think, somewhere in Oklahoma, Broken Arrow, Oklahoma. It was supposed to be like one of the holiest places around with churches and godly people. And as he moved there, it cost money and time. And as he moved there, shortly thereafter, they might struggle. And so it's not about necessarily where you're at, but it's about staying with God. And so anyway, just kind of trusting God, praying, seeking God. Anyway, going back to that story real quick before I go on to this next scripture. Here we are in this little town called Granger, 1,000 population. I get my driver's license. It's so exciting. But as a young kid, get your driver's license. The mom sends you on duties. So I drive about 11 miles up the road to a bigger place where I also used to live, 14,000 population, where they actually had a grocery store. So she would send me and my brother and my sister there with a signed check. And she'd give us a list. We'd drive there, and we'd go through the list. And as we got out to the cash register, I had no money in my name. I didn't even, have a penny to my name yet. But I had a check, and my mom's signature was on the check. I handed it to them, and I guess they knew her. I don't know how it worked, but I just wrote the amount, and we're good to go. And so it's kind of the way it is with prayer, when we declare the name of Yeshua. There's just some power behind that, just like there was power behind that check to get all of these supplies, all of this thing to help our family, simply because my mom's name, the power of her name, the authority of her name was there that I was able to use. Because she said, I want you to use this. I want you to take this. I'm giving this to you. And, I would just say, I don't get this for free. We got baskets full of stuff. We were hungry kids, growing kids. And food isn't cheap. It ain't free. We've been to the grocery store lately. It ain't. I've still got kids, and I've got growing kids. So I know food ain't cheap. And so some of you do too. You've got growing kids. And so, when you're there, you've got to have some kind of a payment. I want you to know that Yeshua has made a payment on our behalf. And we need to take advantage of that. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 8, therefore I desire that men and women, by the way, pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and without doubt. Pray everywhere. Two of the great hindrances to prayer, he lists them there, and I think it's important, wrath and doubting. And I'll just mention just briefly, wrath has to do with bitterness, anger, unforgiveness, and so forth. In other words, I know there's a scripture that says, now, lest as you don't be at odds with your mind, lest your prayers be hindered. And I've mentioned this at times, and I said, I believe it's just also vice versa. there in the book of James, whoever has and doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven, don't let that kind of thing, you know, so forth. So you have to believe, and as you come, you've got to be clean. You know, you can't be full of God, bless me here, bless me there. Oh God, I hate that person, I hate that person. God's going to be like, wait a second, you're asking me to bless it. And you know, there's a scripture there in 1 John that says, I don't have it here with me today, but the idea is you pray and you're going to receive because you keep His commandments. But then it goes on to explain what that means. And primarily the commandments it's talking about is believing in God, believing in Yeshua, and loving one another. And again, it goes right along with this scripture, without wrath, without controversy, and without doubt. Anyway, one last set of scriptures I want to read to you today. And I just want you to think about this. Prayer is really important. Here in Deuteronomy, in Exodus 23, God was sending a messenger. Maybe that messenger wasn't really a person. Maybe it was an angel. Maybe it was intercession. Moses was a mediator. Maybe that messenger was the mediation, the intercession, the supplication of Moses. I don't know what it was. But prayer is still important. And then he goes on, he promises Israel, you serve me, I'm going to bless your bread and your water, maybe even your bananas and how many, and I will take sickness away from you. And then we've also talked about serving God, and we can serve Him through prayer. Hold on, I want to preach. Hold on, I want all this. I want my own bank account. I mean, I want a title. We have to be careful. Some of the most powerful churches or congregations or synagogues are those that have some praying people or maybe a praying ministry. You might be surprised at how much the enemy can come in and how much he can do in individuals' lives, in the community of a congregation of those that aren't up and up on their prayer life. But also just the opposite, it's also amazing at how little power he has over those that are praying up, over the congregations that are built up on their most holy faith praying. Speaking of that, before I go to these last set of scriptures here in the book of Acts, in the armor of God, as it goes through all the armor, which says is important, says to put it on, you'll be able to stand against the evil, blah, blah, blah. At the end of it, it says, and praying. It talks about prayer. And if you look at it there in Ephesians 6, look at it later, not right now, but look at it later, it mentions prayer. That's part of the armor. Prayer is part of the armor. All right, Acts 4. And that God's people were being persecuted. They were being threatened with death, with being beat up. And they were being threatened not to drink, not to speak about Yeshua. And they were let go, being let go. They went to their own company and reported what the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And having turned, they lifted their voice to God with one accord and said, Lord, you are the God who made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. They went to prayer. When they were having problems, they went to prayer. They didn't go to complaining. They didn't go to weeping and bellyaching. They went to prayer. And then they began to pray some crazy things too by the mouth of your servant David and said, why did the heathens, the nations, rage? And the people imagined vain things. The kings of the earth stood up and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against His anointed. And then they continued praying, for truly, he says, for truly, let's see here. Come on. And truly, against your holy child Yeshua, whom you have anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the nations and the people of Israel, were gathered together in order to do whatever your hand, your counsel, determined before to be done. And now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word. Yes. By stretching forth your hand for healing, and miracles and wonders may be done by the name of your holy child, Yeshua. And so when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled was shaken. The very building they were in began to shake. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Spirit, and they spoke the word of God in boldness. There's another time where they were in prison, and they prayed, they worshiped, and the whole jail shook, and people's chains broke off. Prayer is powerful. You release faith in God through prayer, through worship. Some amazing things can happen. You may have to adjust some things. Your mind may not want to. Your flesh may not want to. Remember Messiah praying in the garden? Lord, you know, let this cup pass from me, nevertheless. He's praying. Nevertheless, you know, your will be done. I mean, he's struggling with the flesh. And the flesh wanted to live. He knew it. The flesh needed to die. And, of course, everybody's sleeping. And I thought, guys, can't you turn with me at least, you know, guys? I mean, I think he had to wake him up a couple of times. That's the flesh. God, guys, can you help me over here? And I mean, he's bleeding, you know, sweating as it were, great drops of blood, praying, agonizing prayer, really, you know, looking at what was coming and his future people, that we may often say in some terminology, in the future church or whatever, are sleeping. I don't know, maybe what we need sleep, and God wants us to have a good rest at times. But spiritually speaking, we need to be a God-sleeping people, God-sleeping congregation, God-sleeping body of Messiah, the one that is awake, one that is alert, one that is attentive, one that is on their knees often, one that is crying out to God often. The art of prayer in many places has been lost because it doesn't get the glory. It's not a showful thing. It's not an entertaining thing. It's not a thing that we look at and say, oh, that's so exciting. You know, it's not something we look at and we want to just, you know, it's not something that appeals to the flesh. Many ministers that I've known over the years have said, you know, well, we have a big show or a big famous preacher. We have a big famous music group that are really good. I mean, we've got a lot of crowd. Something happening in the world, the fear of war, or something happening, we got a big crowd coming in, so they're all afraid. We call a prayer meeting, and maybe two people show up, you know. And that's the way it is in a lot of places, because humans are humans no matter where they're at or no matter what they call themselves, whether they're Baptist humans, Pentecostal humans, Messianic humans, they're all humans, and they all have this flesh to deal with. Moses was a great man in prayer. He interceded for Israel over and over and over again. Many times when they got mad at Moses, they accused him. He fell on his face before God in prayer and asked, God, what do I do? Before, a couple of weeks ago, we were talking about that, the bitter water, and he said, God, what do I do? It was through prayer that God showed him a tree. And then later, they're thirsty again, he prays again. A lot of the provision that God came, that came from God, came through the means of Moses' prayer. The victory that Israel got, many times, remember when Moses had his hands up, we talked about that, and they were in battle, and when his hands got weary, Israel began to lose. But when his hands stayed up, Israel was victorious. I think that we can say it was symbolic of faith, of prayer. And I want you to know that if you're praying, I believe God will bring you some victories. But if you neglect your prayer life, just be prepared for some things to happen that you may not necessarily like. So I encourage you, stir your heart and ask God to help you. Pray without ceasing, the word says. Pray without ceasing. And so I encourage you to become a person of prayer. God's put it upon my heart more and more. I read some crazy things. I'll end with this story. And let's see. Okay, good. I've got 1 minute. I'll try to do this in 1 minute and we'll close out. I was reading a story about some individual, and I don't know who this individual was, what they were involved in, but they were involved with witchcraft, basically, whatever category it fell. And even as a young age, they began to deal with demons and all kinds of demonic things. And they had encounters and powers that the devil gave. Demons allowed this young man to have. Later, the young man did this astral projection type stuff where he'd go out of his body and he would attack people and do different, I mean, just crazy things. And he finally got saved. He was in a praying, powerful church, and he was actually went out of his body into this church to attack the church. And he said, all of a sudden, the Spirit of God came upon the pastor, and the pastor began to call out that spirit and began to rebuke it. And he said, the next thing he knew, he was at the altar weeping in his body. He said, he didn't even go there in his body. He went there in spirit. Well, I don't even know how that works, but I want to know. But he said later, as he got saved, he became a preacher or something, he gave testimony. He said when he was in this position, this demonic position, he said whether it be believers, whether it be congregations, he said there were a lot of them that he was able to go and attack them because they weren't people of prayer. But he said there were congregations that were people of prayer and people that were steadfast in the word of God. He said a lot of times he couldn't get close to them. He said he didn't understand it, but he said there was just something about it from his perspective as he went into attack. He said there was groups there, churches that were very carnal, worldly, and he could get in right away and attack and do crazy things. But there were some groups that they were powerful, believing, praying, a group, and he said, he was limited. Sometimes he couldn't do anything there. And I've heard other testimonies similar to that. We might be surprised how prayer helps us in ways we may never even imagine. How it offers things for our families and ourselves we never realized that it offered. It's not all about, my name is Jimmy, I'll take all you give me. Bless me, I don't want to go more. You know, there's the old song we used to sing in a church. And I often wonder about the theology of the song, and I don't remember all the lyrics, but it's something like, bless my, not my uncle, not my aunt, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. So to me, it sounded kind of selfish. I think we all need prayer, but I guess the particular song was like, I need prayer, you know, not all about the preacher, not the teacher, but it's me, you know, it went on and had all these different. But we all need prayer. We really do. Not just me. We all do need prayer. And so I encourage you to become a person of prayer. Don't let the enemy take that away from you. Because powerful praying people will yield powerful lives for God. You've never read about St. Patrick. I encourage you to try to find a good book and read about him. Powerful man of God. I don't know what religion he was, but nonetheless, God used him. I think he started over 300 congregations. But it didn't start that way. It started with prayer. I mean, he connected with God, and then God began to do things. I don't know that I necessarily agree with him theologically and everything. I have no idea. I believe he believed in Messiah. I believe he's in heaven. We never get to Sabbath. He wasn't messianic. As some say, I'm not going to get into all that. But in an amazing man, an amazing life, even last month, Valentine's Day, we look at the history of the man Valentine. And you look at him as he was a minister. And he fell in love. I believe part of the story goes, he fell in love with a blind girl. And I think the part of the story, and again, it's been a while since I've done my research, and I apologize if I'm messing up the story, but the best that I remember, at one point he prayed for her, she was healed, and a lot of her family came to the Lord as a result of it, because he prayed. And so, it's not about the hearts of the Cupids and the chocolate. Chocolate can be good, but it's got an amazing history about this particular man and his faith and what he was trying to do. In ministry and with God. So anyway, let's close out. Thank you for being with me this morning, and we're going to close out with a prayer. What a great way to end the service with prayer. And so it's a great way to start your day, by the way, with prayer. What's great about prayer is you can do it anywhere. I mean, I can do it in the car, I can do it at work, I can do it in the store, I can do it standing up, sitting down, I can do it in the shower. It doesn't matter what I'm wearing, and I mean, it doesn't matter whether I brush my teeth or not, God doesn't care. I mean, it's just amazing. But it's also amazing how many times we neglect it so much. You know, there's other things that we have to do this and that, and we make sure we get that done. But prayer will help, you know. And again, the quote by Corrie Ten Boom, is prayer to you, is it like a steering wheel, or is it just like a spare tire?